There are hundreds of different ways to track the current status of the economy. We can look at the technical indicators, we can look at employment, we can drive around the neighborhood. Assessing the situation from every angle allows us to be more truthful and accepting of reality. We must look at all factors, or we'll be left in the dust when reality sets in. You came here for the truth, so let me unveil that for you. Today we're going to look at shipping, we're going to look at the PMI, so much more. Let's begin by taking a look at this. This is the Baltic Dry Index. Now we can see where it has gone over the years. It is down significantly from 2008, but if we reverse this back, clearly it peaked in 2008, okay? It also made its way up there. But what I want to show you today is that we're nowhere where we were back in that time frame. Okay, so we had this euphoria that was put into place throughout here, and we had the commodities going crazy, stocks were going crazy, housing was going crazy, everything was basically rising. And then reality set in. Okay, nobody thought on the way up to this point here that it would ever drop. It was just going to be perpetual, it's going to continue forever and ever. And then reality set in. All right, so that's what we're at right now, back to the levels we were at many years ago. The Baltic Dry Index is just one indicator. A lot of people want to point to one specific indicator and say that's the reason. It's that reason. And you can do that all day. You can jump around. I like to look at everything, including the most important, as far as I'm concerned, is asking the people who are locally there in that place or work in that industry. And I'm able to get that information. And I ask people to put it in the comment section so that everybody around the world gets it from the source. That's why this is amazing. I get so much information from the subscribers. You guys are amazing. All right, quickly moving on right here. I just wanted to show you dry ships. Now that's just one, as I said here, looking back from, I believe this chart starts off in the early 2000s, and you could see it peaked out in 2008, and then ever since it's basically just been flatlined. That's another one there. Now I'm going to go through these really quickly. Global air freight and sea freight volumes year over year has now declined, along with everything else. Okay, let's be realistic. Throughout 2018, we've seen almost everything has been dropping, and that has been global stocks. We've seen that global stocks, last time I checked, were down 14%, and that is an absolute fact. Many people say the stock market keeps rising, and I say no, FANG stocks have kept rising. We see global systemically important banks are in a bear market. Emerging markets are in a bear market. China's stock market is in a bear market. Okay, but look at this. Global air freight and sea freight volumes are declining. That's not good. We need to see that number increase right now. I mean, we've had all the quantitative easing. We've had all the stimulus. We've had the longest stock bull market, bull BS market in history, and yet we're not seeing that increasing. Why? That's the real economy. That's things moving from place to place, imports and exports. Well, it'll lead me into the point I'll make at the end. We're going to cover a few more of these. China Containerized Freight Index, the CCFI, spot rates. This has been looking very weak over the past few years, and we've seen a lot of that actually coming out of China. The weakness that is just slow and steady throughout these years, ever since the financial crisis, it never really recovered. Shanghai, Singapore, and Hong Kong container throughput year over year. Looking at this as well, I'm noticing that peak was, I mean, depending on which one we're looking at, Hong Kong peaked out in 2017 and the remainder in 2018 along with everything else. But regardless, throughout 2018, we've been seeing a decline. All right, now we have this Global Container Vessel Speed Index. Interesting. Anyway, average container ship vessel speed has also declined since the financial crisis. All right. And then there's this particular company here, I'm not sure how to pronounce it, Maersk Line is laying off 2,000 to 3,000 workers. This was from a few months ago. The company is the container division of this particular company. The resulting news sent a shiver through some local folks biting nails over whether they would decide to build a container shipping facility, and it goes on. All right, so let's remember, when you think about layoffs, what's that going to mean for the industry as a whole? Think about oil, right? So we have different areas which are really big in oil, and as long as oil is doing well, those areas are doing well. So you have the direct people involved, okay, the people who work in the oil company. Then you have the real estate market that surrounds it. And then you have, for example, restaurants, hotels, entertainment that surround those areas. So that's an economy, okay? Everybody's working, everybody is moving things, shipping in and out, gasoline is getting purchased, people are going to the restaurants, people are staying at the hotels, coming in to do business, you have conferences, you have people moving around, okay? That's money, that's economy. But when you see that declining and you have a problem, so that goes with any industry. So if you're looking to buy real estate in a particular environment, make sure it's not dependent on one particular, I would say, for example, oil, right? You don't want it to be just based on oil. If that market is like that, or maybe you would have like Detroit, for example, who have been trying to change their ways over the years, but they're still very much reliant on this old industry that was there previously. The car market isn't what it used to be. They're building those overseas, most of the case, okay? So that's something that we should be worried about. Look at what happened with them. They were a boom town. Things were looking so good for so long. And then they started shipping overseas all the jobs and all the manufacturing. And then suddenly Detroit isn't looking so good. But think about everything that was connected with that. You could say, I'm in the restaurant industry, I'm not in the car business. But of course, it's affected at a later time frame. It might be like sort of a delayed reaction, but that's the way it is. So I just want to make note of that. It has to do with shipping. It has to do with any industry, in fact. So these are just general economic factors that every individual should be looking at on a daily basis. What I love about this channel, I'm just going to say it again, if I want to know about real estate, you know, I can do a search and I could say, what's happening in Stockholm, Sweden? What's happening in Norway? What's happening in Australia? What's happening in Sydney? What's happening in, anywhere? So I'm looking at all these places and I could search that. I could find data online, but I can also ask the subscribers and then ask them to post the information into the comment section. And now everybody around the world who pays attention to this channel is going to be able to find out that information. I think it's really, really informative to hear it directly from the people and then add in all the economic factors that I'm researching on here every day, bringing the videos to you. It's another level. It's a whole nother level. And I'm just so appreciative of all the people that are here and that do share the data with everybody else. We all need to learn this. We are all students. I'm a student. That's the difference between, you go to all these channels, they're gurus. There are literally, I've seen the words financial expert being used for some individuals, and I don't understand what that is. What are you exactly a financial expert about? I don't really understand. Anyway, enough ranting. The United States Manufacturing PMI. Okay, this is important. It has, the amount where we're at today is looking at about above 54.5, it looks like. And that is, I'll show you right here, I'll highlight it. It has dropped somewhat, okay, throughout 2018. But again, along with everything else, it has been a decline year over year or month over month throughout 2018. We're seeing the weakness. It's not the lowest it's ever been. And this is just a short trend going on through 2018. But if I take it back to this peak that we experienced a few years ago, it did decline, it came back up, and now we're on decline again. So we're gonna track this. We're gonna see where it goes. But the point I'm trying to make here is that we should be seeing strength after all the stimulus that has been going on, monetary and fiscal stimulus, everything. I mean, oil, even today, is still historically fairly cheap. That should make everything all connected with it fairly cheap as well, but it's not. That's not happening right now. Oil was at $30 to $40 a barrel for quite a long period of time. That didn't stimulate the economy, didn't do anything. Okay? Nothing changed between, let's say where it was, maybe at $100 a barrel up until the point it dropped $30 a barrel. That didn't stimulate anything. They said it would be good. I didn't see any benefits at all. The gasoline prices barely came down. And still, people are unable to make ends meet. And this is where this leads me to my last point. Negotiations between China and the US at a standstill. Just wanted to show you this right now. They're going back and forth. They're saying, no tariffs on you. No tariffs on you. I'm going to put more tariffs. You put more tariffs. And then I'm going to put more tariffs on top of those tariffs. And nothing's been resolved. Okay? So this is ultimately what we're led to. We have two really, really big, both exporting and importing countries, China and the US, and they are bumping heads. And I've got a problem right now looking at this because I'm thinking to myself, what does that mean for the economies of both of these countries if they can't do business? We need them to be able to do business for this whole thing to work. The domestic consumption can only go so far. Yes, we do see that. We see more and more Chinese moving from the rural areas into the big cities. Definitely happening. We see the same thing happening in the US. There's basically nobody left in the rural areas for the most part. But this needs to still occur. We need more and more and more and more consumption. That's just the way it is. And we're going to see what's going on in the next few months here because it's looking quite troublesome and it's not beneficial for the economy. If you found the video informative, please give me a thumbs up. When you give me a thumbs up, that helps to support the channel. I do appreciate that very much. And I just wanted to say, last but not least, that if you want the financial education that you are not taught in schools, well, these two books have it all. You can actually look through these books if you're interested. There's a link in the description. It's going to take you over to Amazon, and you can actually flip through the pages of these books to see if you like them. And if you're more interested in the audiobook version, you can get that at themoneygps.com.